This time, our filming crew went to the Philippines, where after meeting the staff of AMIA, they took a van and visited two municipalities, Ginyangan in Quezon and Gerona in Tarlac. There, they had a chance to meet the communities and see how these people adapt to climate change. I'm sure you're wondering what AMIA is and why we're all going on this trip. But before starting, remember that the National Adaptation Plan, or NAP, is not only about producing a document, but it's about a real integration into existing planning systems, like with the Adaptation and Mitigation Initiative in Agriculture, or AMIA.
AMIA is the flagship program of the Department on Climate Change Adaptation and Mitigation. But it is really designed as a partnership program. It has never been a program of the department alone.
Partners like the local government units, CSOs, NGOs, and of course farmers, fisher folks, and local communities. Imagine AMIA as a big platform, a climate change instrument that supports both the adaptation and mitigation needs of agriculture in the Philippines and reflects the policy targets for the sector.
So what we want is for local communities to be able to manage climate risk while pursuing sustainable livelihoods. We look at models which have been initiated by NGOs, by CSO partners, and document what are the good practices, and then we scale this out into different parts of the country where these are applicable. We are the fifth most exposed country to climate risks.
Last September, no winds here, but heavy rains came here, and all of us here in this place, you cannot see land. All water here, even that.
This interview took place in Ginyangan, somewhere right behind that hill, where together with Joel, former Undersecretary of the Department of Agriculture and now working for AMIA, we met Juanito Tique, a community local rice variety pioneer.
This lot is dedicated to one variety is testing, and what he has said is that he has not applied any basal fertilizer but fertilized the field 14 days after he has transplanted, and it looks good. The other side is where he's testing a saline tolerant variety. The river there that flows has saline intrusion into it.
Farmers should be researchers. Some of them, they need to test. And to be able to do that, you have to take risk. And some farmers cannot take risk because they do not have resources. So through the program, Climate-Based Adaptation Program of the Department of Agriculture, tie up with IRRR, we have allocated some resources to support farmers' experimentation.
And part of the NAP is exactly to support these types of experiments. But Juanito, known in the community as Captain Johnny, goes a bit beyond that because he's very smart and has a big heart.
He produces seeds which he can make available to the community. Now he gets a lot of visitors. Well, before they just ask for questions, but now they come and visit and observe what he's doing and what he has done and how his crop stand is for the moment.
To better face the threats that climate change poses on the stability of food production, AMIA developed a very interesting tool.
As national government, we should be able to provide them with the tools that would allow them to know these challenges and also the tools or the basket of options that they can choose from. Our program developed the National Color-Coded Agricultural Guide Map. It presents the naturally suitable areas for growing crops, and it overlays the different climate hazards, at least 8 climate hazards based on the 2050 predictions. Our dream is to have a barangay kiosk where farmer can get the information, look at the most suitable areas for their crops, and also know what are their climate challenges and hazards.
Such climate information is used for adaptation planning and decision making. But as someone said, it is also a planning tool to remove guesswork in farming. And finally, the last stop in Ginyangan on board of our cool jeepney was to see how farmers cope with climate change when the weather compromises their harvest, something known as diversification. And it's there that we met pigs and goats and learned from Nina, consultant for AMIA, the story of the breeding facilities.
So when the 11RR came by and they talked about goat raising, she had her doubts because she knows that goats would eat anything actually. But they've shown her how to do it. They helped her construct a goat house, and also they gave her two goats.
The small plants that you see here are not only varieties they are testing to face climate change, but are also something very delicious for goats, with antibiotic properties that protect them from diseases.
She was telling us that because of this additional goat that I have, I was able to send my daughter to college, and she graduated last year. She took up agriculture. Maybe she will one day become a technician in the area because, you know, it was the goats.
Having goats or pigs has been their survival. When they do not have rice, there is typhoon, at least they have some livestock that they can sell.
This area is prone to typhoons, especially typhoons. And also in some areas, they're prone to landslide, and some are prone to flooding, and also drought. So they have all the, you know, they have all these climate hazards actually in this place. That makes them very vulnerable.
Like this month is, and now it's always raining, that is a problem. Not always raining, the people, no walking, no eating.
My dream is to make my farmers an entrepreneur, and so that we don't have problems with our supply.
Adaptation doesn't happen in the short term. It happens over the medium and long term.
One of the ways that he's adjusting to climate change is that he shifted his cropping calendar. So before he started to plant in May, now he plants at the end of June.
Imagine your investments for development being obliterated by one typhoon. And we have 20 typhoons in a year.